Richard is a real expert on what he calls second nature learning. So we're going to experience some of that today. Richard has trained, I think it's about 200,000 people, is that right, Richard?
All in the same room.
All in the same room, all at the same time, across about 30-odd countries. He's also an actor, so you might have even spotted him on the telly before. I was very excited earlier on when I found out he'd been in Series 9 of Spooks. I don't know whether he was a goodie or a baddie yet. I'm going to find that out later on. So I'm going to let Richard, hand over to Richard. We will have time for questions and things, partly during the session and partly towards the end of the session. I'm here merely to make Richard look good. And I will keep an eye on time and things. So I'm going to sit here and wave at him when time's ready. Over to you, Richard.
Thank you very much. Thank you. A big round of applause for Stella, I think. A round of applause. I'm not doing a Darth Vader impersonation. I actually broke my arm in a few places because my last talk was murder, I can say. So what are you all doing? How many, who's learning and development here? Learning and development, very good. HR? Four of you should stick together. IT? Technical design kind of people? Anybody else not been mentioned yet?
Training tech person. Client training tech person.
I like that. That's probably on your card. Anybody else?
University lecturers.
Okay. So, what was it about this particular talk that you wanted to come to, apart from the fact, you know, there's a good lunch beforehand and it's an air-conditioned room? Sorry, I didn't catch that. What is it about? Why engaging learning? Why are we here? Why? What's the point of engaging learning? We've been learning all our lives, haven't we? We went to school, we did a good 18 to 20 something years of that. We had teachers in every single subject. We went to university, we had or college or higher education. We had professors and everything along that. We've done courses, we've done study, we've done online, we've got YouTube, we've seen TED, we've seen everything. So what's the missing bit? A memorable fun experience. Okay, so there's not that much of that, maybe. Very nice, thank you. Anything else?
And getting an emotional connection with your audience so they retain more of the information you're trying to give to them.
All right, so heart, some emotional connection with people. Very nice, thank you. Anything else?
What people do engage with their own learning, to take what's good with their own learning.
Right, so they need to put themselves into something, engage personally with things. Good.
Something they want to learn.
People got to want to learn. So they're motivated, etc. Very good. I wrote a book called What's Your Purpose? Which seemed to me probably the most important question you could ask yourself in a lifetime. Because what's the opposite? It's purposeless, right? So asking ourselves that most important question is what's going to drive the greatest development we could possibly have, it seems. So, engaging learning. It seems to be a subject that is never going out of style. People have looked at how we train, how we learn, how we teach, how we pass on generationally for thousands of years. In Delphi, in ancient Greece, there is an auditorium there which seats 17,000 people. 17,000 people. In London today, that would be a big venue. If you think about the size and the population of ancient Greece then, and say 17,000 people, that's like 20 Wembley stadiums, or stadia. What's the focus of it? What's the purpose of it? It's not like entertainment, it's not EastEnders. It's passing on stories to drive learning, generationally. So let's start to deconstruct some of this. So this is us. Yes, and we're special consultants to the working manager. As Stella said, you know, we've had the privilege of training hundreds of thousands of people around the world in 30 different countries, lots of different languages, with a whole variety of different inputs. We work with people from, you know, blue chip companies, Fortune 50, Coca-Cola, Google, Unilever, people like that. We're doing a lot of work with the EU at the moment, fairly topical. We've worked with school children, we've worked with local authorities, we've worked with refugee groups, you name it. All with the same stuff. People love to say, you know, our people are different, aren't they? Now, we need to learn in a certain way. Our people, we've learned in a certain way. Our people are this kind of person. We can put them in this box with this kind of characteristic. But the truth is, that the stuff that drives us as human beings, drove us as human beings before we put on a suit, and will drive us as human beings when we take the suit off in the evening. And it doesn't seem to change very much around the world, regardless of our culture or our educational background. And the privilege of working with that variety, that spectrum of people, has been that we can observe what the acupuncture points for engaging learning, for driving change, a mindset and behavioral change in people. That's our specialism. How do you drive a mindset and behavioral shift in people en masse? So before I kind of look into a bit of what's involved with that, I just want to tell a little story. There was this great story about a steamboat that broke down in Sydney Harbour at the turn of the 20th century. I don't know if you know this. I don't even know if it's true, but I love the story. So the steamboat breaks down and the captain calls out an engineer, and the engineer gets into his boat, comes out to the ship, and he's got a little tool bag with him, and he goes around the engine room and he starts knocking on things and smelling mixtures and feeling temperatures and stuff like that. And eventually he goes over to one small pipe in a section of the room, and he takes a little hammer out of his pocket, out of his bag, and goes, tap, tap, tap. Okay, start up the engines. They start up the engines, they roar into life, and everybody's like, wow, hats off, well done, very impressive. So he gives the captain his invoice for $5,000. The captain's outraged. $5,000, how dare you charge me $5,000? All you did was tap a pipe. The guy goes, well, if you look closely, I only charged you $5 for tapping the pipe. I charged you $4,995 for knowing where to tap. Just all the consultants, and that's quite a good story for high. So the principle there is that there is a place to tap, which has a massive impact. And if we can find the places to tap, then there is a chain reaction. There is a flow that goes through it. And for us, what we're interested in is that place to tap. That tiny thing that you go tap, tap, tap there, and something very significant happens the other end. So everything we want to look at today are the places to tap. Does that make sense? So change, that seems to be a bit of a biggie. Doesn't seem to be going away. What is it that drives organizational change? What's the DNA of change? So designing change programs for nearly 25 years now, there are some things that are consistent throughout that process. What are they? Let's have a look. Number one, no surprises there, strategy, strategic change. We've got to have a change of strategy if we're going to have a new direction. We have a new direction, that gives us a roadmap, we can plan to go that way, everybody understands it, etc. Two, processes, very simple, normally owned by middle management around there, people, processes designed to support strategic change. And as somebody once famously said, processes are the memory of an organization. They're all the stuff we've realized has worked. We write it down, we organize it in different processes, different ways of doing things, mostly on spreadsheets, and away we go, and that way we can keep consistent. But the third area, and this is the most significant point, is this: mindset and behavioral change. Now, most organizations look at strategy and processes, and they go, right, we understand that if we're going to drive change, if we're going to create a shift in our people, if we're going to change our results, we need to change the way we're doing things, so we'll develop strategy and we'll develop processes. But they don't do this bit, or they forget it. But without it, it's incomplete. It's an impossibility to change an organisation, especially en masse, without affecting people's mindsets or behaviours. Have you ever seen a beautifully sculpted kind of garden or park? You know, you've got this lovely patch of green and a kind of an S-shaped pattern made out of flagstones moving through it like this, and the landscape architect has put it down. It looks fantastic. And then 2 weeks later, you see this path that people have trodden across the grass. Have you ever seen that? They call that a desire line. Architects call that a desire line because regardless of how constructed we are in our heads about the way things are going to be, people have a certain behavior and they find their way. We could change the way we design roads, we could change the design of the car, but if people like taking corners at 80 miles an hour, they'll find a way of doing it. It's not optional. It's not optional. And yet most of the time it's forgotten. Why? Because the people who say, right, we need to change and we're going to work out strategy and processes, most of the people at that level, we've grown up in the 80s and 90s and noughties, and it wasn't current. So we took on from our peers and we just learned that that's the way things are, and so we perpetuate the status quo, more or less. We have a little bit of incremental change, and a few organizations do some radical change, but generally we kind of cut and paste the past onto the future a bit. The other thing is, it's harder to measure. We're quite comfortable with KPIs on strategy and processes. Mindset and behaviors, people go, well, it's a bit tree huggy, isn't it? Can we do that? You know, do we not have to do wholemeal socks and knitted tea to be able to measure mindsets and behaviors? A bit touchy-feely, don't know if we can put that on a spreadsheet. We can measure them all, but they require a different mindset, a different way of looking at things, a different way of viewing people. So Albert said famously, you know, you can't resolve a problem with the same mindset you used to create it, which is where we get the expression outside the box, outside the framework. If we're going to create change, incremental, radical, lasting change, we have to shift mindsets. It's not optional. None of those three are. So now we kind of get to the meat of this. The iceberg model is basically our mind. The top of the iceberg, the tip of the iceberg, is our consciousness, our conscious mind. Underneath is the unconscious mind. Strategy and processes are largely worked out in the conscious mind. We sit around, we talk about them very articulately, we email them to each other, we write about them. We have to be very conscious and lucid about these things because we need to engage people with it. So that's where they exist, and that's where the measurements lie. But mindset and behaviors are triggered here, aren't they? Every mammal on the planet is born programmed to play. Amazing. Because we're not based in instinct. And because we're not based in instinct, we have to learn. We have to learn really quickly. We have to get up to speed. And play is just like nature's accelerated learning. So that's the fastest learning state we could possibly achieve. Therefore, program all mammals with play. Which always comes in, play is creative, isn't it? We play with life, we work things out, we try things out, we experiment, we explore. Comes in through the creative mind, through the right brain. When we sleep, we dream. The right brain, the creative mind never switches off, never, ever switches off. Do we try and turn off our conscious mind? When we go home, do we sit home and go, oh, thank God I can settle down in front of a really nice spreadsheet? We go home, we watch a film, or we read a book. We're quite happy to engage in the unconscious, in the storytelling, metaphorical, creative mind. It influences everything that we do, and we can't switch it off, and we can't ignore it. It's impossible to ignore it. Don't picture elephants. Take the pictures of elephants out of your mind. Stop thinking about elephants. Don't make those elephants pink in your mind. Don't make them fly upside down, wearing a tutu, singing the Hallelujah chorus. Don't do that. Get those pictures out. Anybody got pictures of pink elephants flying upside down? Impossible to ignore. This mindsets and behaviors, the unconscious, is sponsoring everything that goes onto the top through the conscious mind. So that's a given, right? That's how we are. That's how we're all built on the planet. So then we've got an issue here, which is that most of our training, our learning and development, is done through the conscious mind, through the conscious bit. So if we were going to, we're banging away at this to try and influence that, and we cannot get lasting change in terms of mindset and behaviors by hitting the conscious mind, by bashing it. We get people switching off, don't we? Do you ever sit in a meeting and zone out? Have we ever read about people who sit in meetings and zone out? Have you ever do that? And then we start thinking about something else or doodling. Anybody here doodle? Is that your unconscious mind going, let me out? We're trying to engage with something else. It's there, we can't turn it off. Now, it's happening, we're having to find a way out because what's going on is only attracting the conscious mind, and that's not all of who we are. That's a tiny fraction of who we are. Really important, but not the whole story. How could we possibly engage the whole person only dealing with the conscious mind? So my question is, how do we use the conscious mind, because that's the awake bit, to access this? How do we Google the unconsciousness? How do we Google it and make us more effective? And if we can, if it's possible to Google the unconscious, where would we apply that? What would be the places to tap which would give us the greatest levels of effectiveness and the greatest possibilities of connecting? That, in essence, is what we call second nature learning. So I just want to explore this a little bit more. Does it make sense so far? And I'm thinking, no, it's rubbish. It doesn't work. We don't have an unconscious. No? Okay, good. So, anybody ever been on a presentation skills course? Anyone been on presentation skills, public speaking, anything like that? What are the kind of things they recommend that you do to engage people in public speaking? Eye contact, okay, very good. Keep people in eye contact. Physical body language, sorry.
Storytelling.
Storytelling, very nice.
Humour.
Huh? Humour, excellent.
Know your audience.
Know your audience, so give us a way of connecting. Anybody ever said, yep? Games, very good, lovely. Really engaging, so asking questions, rhetorical questions, direct questions. Metaphor, has that ever come up? Yeah, using metaphor, okay. So, this is our, just kind of our example of traditional learning, where somebody at the front, flip chart, nice suit, will talk you through presentation skills, give lots of very good advice, we'll write it down, we'll have it in books or in slides or in a PDF or something else that we'll take away with us, and it all makes sense. It's good advice. Go away, use metaphors, bring them in as much as you possibly can, and we go, great. They give some examples, we get the idea. Okay. It remains a recommendation. I am recommending that you use metaphors. We kind of get used to this. 2 weeks later, someone's giving a talk, or we're writing our presentation, and we go, oh, I've had that recommended, I've got to use metaphors, how exactly do I do that? I know I should, but unless someone's told me a metaphor that relates to that, I kind of get the idea, but there's a difference between the idea and the behavior embodying it, isn't there? Isn't that why I have a lot of people, chief execs, who say, why aren't our people doing this? And I said, what have you tried so far? And they said, well, I told them we need to be more agile. B Be more agile. Be funny now. We get the idea. We get the idea. We understand what they mean. But does that mean we embody it? What's the connection then? So, if we are not natural storytellers, if it's not part of our normal behavioural DNA, we don't know how to apply the recommendation. So this is what we're talking about with second nature learning. You ever said that before? It's a bit like? Everything that follows the words "it's a bit like" is an analogy or a metaphor. And we don't need to learn how to do it because we already know how to do it. We've always known how to do it. When we were kids, we knew how to do it. When we were kids, we used it all the time. That rings a bell. Terrible jokes. Was there a teacher that stood out for you at school? Was there one or two teachers who were really different and really stood out for you? What was it they did that was different?
They were rubbish.
They were what? They were rubbish? Very good. I wish I went to your school. Okay, very nice. Who stood out in a way that you enjoyed, that you liked? Yep.
I had a history teacher who didn't like having the eighth, but more importantly, got into the real nitty-gritty, the social stuff. Horrible history as it is now.
Horrible history, so good storytelling.
Yeah.
Very nice, thank you. There's one back here.
She used to sit on her desk in tracksuit bottoms and T-shirts with Shakespeare on and things, so she was an English teacher.
All right, so very passionate. Excellent. Anybody else? Yep.
So, no matter what you said, you believed it.
You believed it, or they believed it, or both?
That's the teacher. No matter what you said, everyone was engaged and could believe.
Excellent. Did any of those people use metaphors and stories to make their points? Do we remember Henry VIII, however many years on? I won't even guess how many years on. Which shows us it's a massively powerful tool and it's a perfect connector. So, second nature learning, the essence of it is to take us from recommendation, good idea, concept, to being able to embody it every single time, forever and ever, amen. And to be able to translate that universe, those universal principles of effectiveness into very simple triggers. So, once you can do that, what happens? It feels ridiculously simple, doesn't it? Does it feel ridiculously simple? It's a bit like? Can I borrow you for a sec? Can you stand there for me? I normally only take volunteers from the back, so you were very lucky this time. So I've asked them to come up before I told him why I asked him to come up, so forgive me for this. So I used to do lots of martial arts, and I just wanted to do a...
Me too.
Really? In that case, you can sit down again. I'd like a very small person, if you like. So just as we're avoiding the microphone, you just grab my collar for a sec. So as a metaphor, as an it's a bit like, right? So in karate, people would do lots of very kind of aggressive things, use a lot of effort. Here, so here, strike here, eardrums, nose. It's aggressive, it's powerful, it's forceful, it uses a lot of muscular effort, right? But Aikido, have you ever seen Aikido? It's beautifully elegant and refined. In Aikido, if you have the right place to tap, the right point of leverage, that takes no strength. Can you feel it?
Yeah.
But has a big impact, and it doesn't require effort. There's no relationship between effort and effectiveness. Thank you. Give him a round of applause. Very nice. Thank you, Clay. Thank you. My 10-year-old son can put me on the floor using points of leverage. And if we understand what those points of leverage are, we can have that massive impact. Same thing as the place to tap. So it's a bit like, for example. Very simple. That's very simple when you know how. Because it's so simple, it feels so familiar to people. Because it feels so familiar, it doesn't feel like they're learning. It feels like you're articulating something to people that they already knew but didn't know that they knew, which is Googling the unconscious. They already knew it, it's in the unconscious. Most of the time when we're training people, we're encouraging them, we're finding ways to help them do what they do at their best every day. Peak performance all the time. The new norm, upgrade. So, it already feels familiar. Because it feels familiar, it feels, and they understand the uses of it, they want to apply it elsewhere. They don't just think that I turn on presentation skills when I walk into a presentation room. If you're a really good communicator, if you're a compelling communicator, that works just as well on the phone, as on paper, as on email, as in documents, as with one's kids, as with one's spouse, as in a difficult situation. The muscle group is there. So people tend to apply it holistically, universally. And because it's the essence of our nature to talk, think, communicate in metaphors, when we're effective, it works in all cultures. So some of the organizations we work with have 28, 30 different languages being spoken in the organization, don't they? And because of that, when people try to generate understanding, when they're using English, which is their second or third language, you get 10 people around a room, in a room, and English is their second or third languages, and they're all trying to find some common points of understanding. How many times are people going like this, but thinking something completely different? Wouldn't it be amazing to be able to see into people's thought bubbles and go, that's not what I meant? But when we find a very good metaphor, we get the resonant understanding. Resonant understanding is totally different. We said before, we were having a conversation just before we started here. And we're saying there's a load of amazing technical gadgets downstairs, aren't there? There's lots of fantastic digital ways of learning. And all the new ways do not necessarily communicate more deeply. They just communicate more. Having an amazing pen does not make one a writer. But if one is an amazing writer, one can use these extraordinary pens in extraordinary ways. It's a bit like being a writer. So using these metaphors as a universal connector. Okay. Let's go to the next stage of this. It's one thing to be able to narrow it down to the tiny triggers, these little points of leverage, which give people accelerated understanding and connection. And then you go, okay, well, where else can I use this tool? Well, again, it works across hierarchies, cross-cultural communication, meetings. When do we get the nods around the table? Is when people really get it. Really nice choice of metaphor in that circumstance makes that happen. Sales, people will talk about that in sales process. Again, we talked about presentations, networking, problem solving. One of the things we do with organizations now is use metaphors as a problem solving process. So that somebody identifies what a problem is, then takes a metaphor of that problem, then we solve that in all sorts of interesting and funky ways. Just the metaphor. Aristotle said you only ever need to be a master of metaphor. Something exists in several places, you get the universal truth. So the solutions that work for the metaphor are going to work for the original problem. We solve them here, then apply those solutions back to the original problem. One of the law firms we work with needed to cut 30% of their headcount. It was a very difficult problem. They couldn't get into the way of solving that problem without it being emotionally charged, as you can imagine, as one would hope, actually. So we helped them solve the problem through a metaphor. They developed an amazing metaphor, we solved the problem in the metaphor, applied it back, and then they came up with a totally different solution. Not losing 30% of their people, but taking 30% of their people and putting them in an outsourced organization, which then could live on its own and use them as a client. Something totally different they'd never considered. They achieved that in just under 40 minutes. Now, from that point of view, if you can do that, if you and I work in the same organization, and I have an it's a bit like for my problem, I can send you my it's a bit like and ask you to come up with solutions. You can send me back your solutions. Once you've sent back your solutions, you're more creative, you go on to your next meeting, you have more capacity. I then get a whole load of solutions from you, or from you, or from you, or from you, and you don't even know what my original problem is. I can now start to engage thousands of people in crowdsourcing understanding by using a common interface, such as metaphors, which we already know how to use. Einstein said that that kind of capacity is the is a core of genius, the ability to radically create at any point, at any moment. Thank you very much. So, I suppose what I'm saying here is that while these things are simple, I've never found that complicated is actioned. I never found that when we get very complicated pyramid diagrams on the wall telling us how, you know, that leadership works according to this graph and this pyramid and this thing and that thing, I've never found anyone go, I know exactly what to do now. Simple does work. Apple was going to go under, came out with the iPod. It was the first piece of complex technical kit that was sold without an instruction manual. Because there's only one button. You do that or do that. That's it. You just play around with it and it works. Simple was why we've got iPhones in our pockets, really. So, it gives us universal understanding. It gives us all these different applications. It helps us extend our learning because there's not very much to learn. So it's universal, and once you can do it through second nature learning, you can do it digitally. Which means that we can drive behavioral change, mindset and behavioral change digitally, real mindset and behavioral change that people can action. Not recommendation, not box ticking. It's a bit like, for example, becomes a prompt after that. Same with the answer could be, same with a thousand others that we've developed as well alongside it. So, now we get to a bigger level. If we can do that, if we can drive behavioral change digitally, if you can change people's mindsets through email, through online learning, etc., what do you want to change? What are the places to tap that give us the greatest outputs for our interpersonal effectiveness? So I'm going to go through what where we've come to with this, if you like, if this is useful for you. How long have we got, by the way? Okay. I'd love these to be four C's, because then I could say, may the four C's be with you, but I can't, unfortunately. So communication, we talked kind of a bit about that. When any organization we go into and we say, okay, what could we change around here with which would give us the greatest leap forward in the organization, they always go, oh, communication, oh. It's the way we communicate. If we just communicated differently, better, more effectively. So, communication. It is our interpersonal interface, isn't it? Collaboration, the ability to work together. As far as I'm concerned, the ability to work together. People talk about building great teams, and I don't think it's about great teams. I think it's about great team working. I think a great team worker can work with anybody on any capacity. I think it's the core of leadership skills. There are lots of people who can talk, who can stand out the front and give inspiring addresses and stuff, but can they really work with people? So collaboration must be a core of leadership. Creativity, the kernel, the essence of all problem solving, of innovation, of problem solving, of paradigm shift thinking, the ability to change, flexibility, improvisation, humor, change. How many people do you think are really good at this? Are there lots of people who go, oh, I love change. Someone goes, we're going to run a change program. Our organization is going to go through great changes. People go, fantastic. Hey, high-fiving in the canteen. they normally resort to the rumour net, don't they? Oh, you know, yeah, what's going to happen? So and so's for the chop. They're going to get rid of everybody. There's going to be three people left in the whole organisation. And even they're going to get a pay cut. All the stories people tell about change are bad stories about the future. They're not all, because we're the enlightened group who are in learning and development, right? We understand that. But people's tendency is their default. This, for me, is the new constant. So not only is it a new constant, you remember, if anybody's old enough, back in the 90s, people went on Microsoft Word courses. Anybody remember that? Seems like fictional now, doesn't it? Ridiculous, you know? Microsoft, yeah, 5 days. What are you doing? 5 days, I'm doing a Microsoft Word course. Really? Can you imagine saying that to somebody today? What are you doing? Can you come to my meeting? It's like, oh, sorry, I can't do that. I'm on a Microsoft Word course. Followed by PowerPoint the week after. You think they were nuts? In 10 years' time, 20 years' time, change is going to be the new Microsoft Word. It'll seem ridiculous to us to have to learn about change. Why? Because it's the water we swim in. Care. Nothing else matters unless we got that. Because no human is an island. And if we're working together, and nothing that we can see around us could possibly be created without people working together, if there's no care, there's no point. Purpose helps people care. They know what they care about, and they give themselves to it. And like you said, with every great teacher, the ability to shape lives, influence people, and be a good person. I mean, it's very simple in the end, but we don't spend much time talking about it. So for these, 5 C's are, for us, the places to tap with second nature learning. We'll hear more about this later. We're going to do this in a moment. But the last things to say about this is that what runs through all of these as themes is, number one, leadership. I don't mean being in positions of authority. I don't think leadership and being in a position of authority is the same thing. As far as I'm concerned, if you spot it, you can shift it. I said shift it. You can change it. The person in the meeting that realizes that something's gone off track, that nothing's happening, that somebody's talking for ages and we're not being able to get to the point, that we don't have actions, that we're on agenda point 3, there's 5 minutes to go and there are 15 other points to get through, blah, blah, blah. The person who spots these things happening is the one, that's leadership, the one who shifts it, the one who changes it. The one who stands up and makes the choice, as opposed to waiting for permission to be a leader. Facilitation, the ability to enable the people around us. And presencing, being in the moment here now. I work with one organization, massive organization, I can't mention them, but you know, brains the size of planets. And they couldn't go to a meeting without 5 slides prepared. If you've got 5 slides prepared, you want to use them, don't you? If you write your script for a presentation, you're stuck to your script, reading your script, and actually where I am when I'm reading my script is the place I was when I sat down to write it. I'm not here. How can we possibly respond to the living moment, to what's really going on, to listening to people, to understanding, to connecting with them, to be able to make dynamic progress as we're here. It seems like through the myth of being safe, risk aversion, that we've moved away from presencing. If we can do that, if we can stay present, those 5 C's, those 3 traits, gives us the ability to improve any situation spontaneously. Improvisation. I used to do a lot of improv. I've always done lots of improv. I used to do, I was part of the BBC's light entertainment impro team, which was, you know, Saturday night, 15 million people, guy in your ear going, say this to him. And you'd have to kind of turn it on. So, you know, we learned a lot about impro under those circumstances. And as Shakespeare said, all the world's a stage, so the meeting room, as much as anything else, improvisation, the ability to spontaneously improve any circumstance. So just a couple of examples around this. How this translated to digital learning was this was one circumstance. It was an undersea construction company. They were making an announcement on one particular day, and they knew that that was going to have shockwaves. If people have not got their eyes, are not present, not got their eye on the ball, are not concentrating on what they're doing with 300 tons swinging on deck and huge waves crashing over the deck, they die. So how could we train people on 1,500 ships across the world on the same day to be able to deal with complex interpersonal dynamics? And it had to be done digitally, and it had to be behavioural, and we brought in a lot of humour, and we brought in this hybrid of comic book and video, and gave people choices and templates that they could use. I'll go very quickly, and we can pick up the rest in questions if you like. This was a mindfulness program. It can get quite complex, mindfulness, in some ways. So we created a very naive style so that it seemed dead simple, using film and using metaphor, storytelling, analogy, be able to put it into practice. Creativity. These are all programs we've developed. Some are bespoke and some off the shelf. For people to be able to be spontaneously effective, to access their creative muscle, and to be able to create paradigm shift thoughts. I did a program, I came back last night from a program with the EU, where we needed to create a number of paradigm shifting ideas, which normally take 4 or 5 days with people in a smoke-filled room going away, going, we must think of something new. And they came out in 25 minutes. Just little places to tap, little acupuncture points in the unconscious, just keep on twisting them. And they come out, so they'll be on the news. Meetings, is that an issue for anybody? No? We all love our meetings. Do you know the stats on meetings? This is the big one. You ask people in middle management and above, how much of your time do you spend, what percentage of your time do you spend in meetings? What do you think they say?
Too much.
Too much, yeah. They go, oh. 60%, somebody whispered, somebody else, any other thoughts? Any advance on 60?
80.
Who thinks like 20%? Okay, so we're between 60 and 80%. So this stage, let's say that's my life at work. So from here to here, that's about the amount of time I spend in meetings, right? So what percentage of that time is really effective, 8, 9, 10 out of 10 effective? If you ask people, they would say, 10, 9%, somebody else said?
20.
Most of the time people say 20% of the people leading the meetings. I don't know if that's, no. There was somebody over here said one. No? Okay, so the average is 5 to 10%. 5 to 10% of this is really effective. That's that. That leaves us just over 50% of all my life at work in meetings that go nowhere. I mean, in another age, we would call that purgatory, wouldn't we? We spend 41 to 50% of our lives at work. So if half of that is in meetings going nowhere, so we live to be 80, 40 years at work, roughly, let's say 35 years at work, so half of that. So we're spending 17, 18 years, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in meetings where some guy can't get to the point, where people are having some kind of political conversation. I don't know where this is going. 18 years. So that's why we created this program. And just want to give a very brief example of another two, and then we'll take some questions and have some chat. This was different. This takes second nature learning and puts it into a different sphere. This was an ethics program. Essentially, it's about designed to shift mindsets digitally in 70,000 people in 80 countries, but only sending them one or two sheets every time. We call it a mindset funnel, by giving people criteria by which they make their decisions, but the freedom to be creative within that. We set dilemmas in this kind of hybrid of animation, infographic style way, and get their decision making and can have a real time conversation with 70,000 people. This one takes the principles of second nature learning, turns it into games. This was a game played in teams in 12 countries and 9 time zones, getting them to work more effectively virtually than they would do if they got together in the same place. So we called it the Race to Valhalla, and we got them dressed up as Vikings to play the game. And we said they were only allowed to play for 10 minutes per day. Not allowed to play more, so they had to pack it in, gave them very hard tasks to achieve together as one group, but then gave them training a few days before, so they definitely applied that training to achieve the tasks. And every day they could check in and see whose longboat is fastest and going to get to Valhalla first. Every once in a while, we would have webinars by Thor, as you can see by the hair, which we called Thoughts. I know. And that was the Race to Valhalla. So those are just some applications of second nature learning in those 5 C's and in that way. Now, I want to go a little bit further and just take 5 minutes or 10 minutes just to get thoughts from you about any of this. And then there's a kind of a second part, which is zoom out again and go for a bigger picture of what's going on now. We've got 20 minutes left. So what do you think? Yes, boss.
How do you measure whether the training is effective on the longer term? Do you have any information on that?
It's a great question. How do you measure? How do we know that this stuff works?
Yeah, how do you know that it still works after let's say 6 months?
Okay.
Immediately after a training, well, there must be an effect, because otherwise you've done a pretty lousy job. But after 6 months, after the bill is paid, after the project is rolled out, what happens then, and how can you make sure?
I've got anecdotal and metrics. So one metric, very strong metric, one working with the construction company that built the Olympic Stadium and the Eden project, things like that. They won £1.9 billion worth of new business in the first 2 years of doing the program, of the presentation skills, communication skills program, entirely based on that. And consistently, when you're very effective, you kind of use it a lot. So they keep on using it. Anecdotally, people we worked with 20 years ago, still email, we see them still say, I've kept that book that you did 20 years ago with those, we still use that tool, I've still got it in my briefcase, that kind of stuff. So there's two measures on that. Meetings saves people 30 to 50% of the time they spend in meetings. So on average, we did a study with one group. They have 500 people in the organization. They say that that earns them essentially one day a week per person back. That's 500 days a week they earn back. A year and a half they earn back every week. Mind-blowing, isn't it? So that's a consistent figure that we've gone back to them again and again and again. People on the purpose program, what's your purpose from the book and the program that around about that, again, consistently say they're applying their purpose in all sorts of new and diverse ways. It grows and it deepens. More often than not, which is lovely, is that people come back and talk about the different ways that they use it. How they use it's a bit like with their kids. How they use a technique called the Magic 7, 7 word keys around communication. To grow their learning. So they're very strong metrics if you look for them, and long-term as well. Does that answer the question?
Yes, it does.
Thank you.
I noticed that you use a lot of cartoons in my way of training. And is there a reason why you choose for it? Because I'm very interested in why you use that type of.
Excellent, thank you. So why use cartoons? Well, first and foremost, because it gives me a chance to dress up as Thor. And, you know, what other reason does one need? Now, the beauty of cartoons, there's lots of different ways of doing it. But one of the main reasons that we developed it is because you have thought bubbles and speech bubbles. Thought bubbles and speech bubbles start to iconize people's attitudes and behaviors. You can see what people are thinking, which drive their actions. You can see what they're saying, which may differ or be in alignment to what they're thinking. You can develop a subtext of what goes on. So we'd often build films into what we do where two people are talking, and for comedy benefit, one of those people, the color would drain from their face, or they just literally die while the other person carries on talking, etc. So we can build in a lot of subtext very quickly into storytelling, and we found that using that form, we could tell in 2 to 3 minutes what would normally would take in 15 minutes of traditional storytelling.
Thank you.
The other one that we're thinking about as well is actually where you can click on people's thought bubbles and write in different thoughts, or drag different thoughts on top of a character, see how they turn out. Thank you. Welcome. Anybody else? Any other thoughts? Any other questions? Yeah.
Well, it's more, I'm fascinated. I get the use of metaphor. I think it would be brilliant. I work in a compliance team and we're trying to change behaviours and inspire and motivate people. How easy or hard is it to get metaphors to fit for your ethics work, you were saying? You know, did you find that the organisation responded very well to that? I couldn't see whether there was metaphors used in those materials.
There's lots of layers of metaphor used in those materials, but in all the work that we do, really. I've not yet found a place where metaphors don't sit well. We've talked about metaphors because they're a useful tool, but we do second nature learning with creativity, with communication, with all the other forms as well. So it's not just the sole tool that we use. If people find resistance to using a metaphor overtly, then we say, get technical first. This is the ABC of the BCG of the RSVP of the PDQ. It's a bit like saying this. And then they get the nod on the it's a bit like.
Yeah.
So we say use both of them until you feel comfortable just using the metaphor as it stands. But the truth is it's the metaphor that shifts them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If that makes sense, thank you.
Yeah.
Anything else or? Just, yep. Yeah. So the ethical program would take us a bit too long to go into to be able to look at the metaphorical nature of it. But let's talk about this. So on one of the principles of mindfulness, we talked about limiting beliefs. People have a limiting belief about what they're capable of. And that limiting belief then drives their actions, and their actions then drive the way they communicate, and if they can have ideas, etc. So we said, well, it's a bit like the way they train elephants in India. When they're babies, they chain them up to a pole that's in the ground, and they pull and they pull and they can't get away. So after a while, they develop a belief that I can't get away. Then they grow and grow and grow, and they're very strong. And in the end, the pole is not even in the ground. It's just lying on top of the floor. But the elephant thinks, I've got a chain around my leg, so it doesn't even bother thinking that it could move away. It's got a limiting belief. How many of those limiting beliefs are we carrying around the things that we want to achieve? The elephant then becomes an icon. It's a beautiful metaphor, an icon which then sits with the limiting belief thing, and as soon as somebody sees the elephant there later, they get it. Then you can turn that digitally by saying, okay, you put down your belief around this. Is it an elephant or is it a this?
Yeah. Thank you.
Very welcome. How long have we got?
15 minutes.
15 minutes. Can we go big for a sec, people? Thank you for that overwhelming round of enthusiasm. So I just want to share this. I think it's really important. It's a big year, isn't it, this year? This guy's been in power for a week. I think we are moving into the biggest, the greatest pace and rate of change, the greatest period of change that we, anybody in this room, has ever experienced on a global scale. And it's only getting faster. Brexit, Trump, things in the outside world which destabilize or change markets or change opinions or change public feeling or change demographics, etc., all around. And we've got major elections in Europe this year and we've just finished January. Moving fast. When this guy was around, if Brontosaurus was around, food was so plentiful that it could eat and eat and eat, didn't even think about it. It was just like reach up there, and it grew bigger and bigger and bigger. And because it grew so large, it got slower and slower and slower. And eventually it couldn't produce enough energy to break down the food in its stomach. So it started to eat other kinds of food to get new enzymes in its stomach to break down the other food that it was eating. So guess what? Grew bigger. After a while, the enzymes weren't doing the trick, so it started to eat gravel and rocks alongside its food, so that could rub against the other food in its stomach and break down the food. So guess what? Got bigger. In the end, it was the size of a three-story building, and at a full sprint, Usain Bolt, downhill with the following wind, would go at 4 miles per hour. The same speed as normal walking pace for us. Doesn't take a genius to work out that the moment something happens, comet comes in, ice age starts to creep, Tyrannosaurus Rex, by the time it turns its head around, bang, it's wiped out. So my contention is this. We have a lot of systems, processes in place that we don't even realize are going on that slow us down massively in organizations. How long does it take to get people around a table? Weeks sometimes. Once they're around the table, how long does it take to get where we need to go? To then get a plan out, to then get the right people, to then get the right resource. It could be months. By the time those months go by, the initial thing that we were responding to is out of date. We have so many control structures in place which are a response to risk aversion, our forms of risk aversion, really useful, interesting thinking most of the time. However, they've come to the point where they've become a burden in so many capacities that it stops us evolving. It stops us being able to achieve agility. And even if we say, thou shalt be agile, that's a recommendation. And it doesn't happen because the system, we don't even know that we're being constrained by these systems. So I'd like to introduce another possibility. You ever seen this? A murmuration. Isn't that a beautiful word? Thousands and thousands of these birds working in perfect unison. Self-evolving systems. They avoid predators. They avoid obstacles. They learn and grow and evolve through osmosis by being in connection with each other. Different parts of the cloud can act in totally different ways to other parts of the cloud and yet still remain cohesive. They have 5 organizing principles that give them this level of agility and cohesion en masse. They work more effectively than any human group ever studied together, and they have brains the size of peanuts. for us, this is our it's a bit like for how organisations need to respond to the status quo so that we don't become dinosaurs, brontosauruses. So, I'm going to pop through this fairly briskly. These waves of change are coming thicker and faster, and they're constant. They used to come in sets, and now they're continuous. Most people, their default response to waves, when have you ever been in a big sea? 12-foot waves crashing over your head? Anyone had that? It's frightening, right? I mean, it's, unless you're an amazing swimmer, even if you're an amazing swimmer, they're big. So most people, they hang on, they try and develop a strategy to go under it, to get out of the way a little bit, to move out of the way. We develop a coping strategy with it, which most people develop a coping strategy when it comes to change. They will suffer it for a while. And yet, this is one of the most spectacular forces on the planet. You ever seen people do that? That's the opposite. That's the opposite way of engaging with the wave, is to surf. Suffer or surf seems to be the possibility here. We need to be able to do it in ways. We need to be able to evolve agilely, to self-evolve as systems, in ways where parts of the wave can respond to the outside world in a different way to other parts of the wave. Hierarchy at the top, looking at the bigger picture, cannot possibly see all parts of the picture. We can't, can we? How can I, over here, surrounded by the 10, 12 people that I have, with the data that I have, even possibly get to see the market forces or the forces that are affecting that part of the organization down there, or that part of the organization down there, or that part of the organization down there? And yet, the people in this part of the organization down here are waiting for permission from that level, that level, that level, and that level to say, thou shalt do this. Okay, now I'll do that. It starts too late. If we can do what the guys with brains the size of peanuts can do, we don't need that. We evolve beyond the level of control. And control has been really useful up to a point because we felt like we're safe. But when it becomes this slow, it's not safe anymore. So, we think we need to be able to create self-evolving systems. And that requires a new quality of leadership, a facilitatory enabling style of leadership. Still leadership. In fact, more courageous in many ways. Much more courageous. You need more courage not to control. To release new levels of potential in people. The five C's. With leadership, with facilitation, with presencing, improvisers, are the same as the five principles that the Starlings have, which work in any number. Self-evolving systems. And they work because they're already second nature. They're already part of our operating system, deeply embedded and connected between the conscious and the unconscious. The Starlings program, which is what we're, this is our opus really, takes kind of app style system with an interface which is radical. This is not the picture of the interface, this is just a diagram. Which triggers the unconscious and the conscious, which gives people 80% of the control of their own learning and macro learning as well, which responds to people in real time, where you get to understand what's happening in real time as an HR director, as a learning development director, as a CEO, which build these five principles in, and which takes content which is within LMS and open source, and circulates that and socializes it and gives people a currency for contribution. Blended with interactive theater, immersive experiences, scenarios where people get to change what happens on stage by popping thoughts into other people's heads, by replacing actors on stage, by trying things out, by taking 100 people in a room and getting involved in a story. 100 people with 10 years experience apiece is 1,000 years worth of experience. What does it know? Can we afford, do we want to continue without knowing what it knows? Blend that, film that, take the resource of the thousands and thousands and thousands of years worth of experience, all exercised with humor and light, and feed it back into the online and feed that back into our immersive interactive experience, and we have an ecosystem here. And that, in essence, is Starlings, which is a response to that. Which answers the question of Brontosaurus or Starling, suffer or surf. So, thank you very much. I'd love to answer questions if there are any.
Questions for Richard? Minutes left, so if anyone's got any quick questions, Richard would love to answer them for you. Anyone got any burning question? I've got one if you haven't. You've got one?
Yes.
Have you ever had projects or companies in which your trick didn't really work, in which, well, your project failed. Well, it didn't really was as successful as you thought it would be. And what would the reason be behind that? Because that would be a very good learning lesson.
It would be. My pole dancing career was cut, unfortunately, short. what hasn't worked? I wondered if working with the scientific body, the EU, was going to make it come a cropper, actually, because it was so regimented and so process driven. And yet, actually, what's happened has been exactly the opposite. And what I learned from that, which is just as valuable, actually, because they're based in Italy. And so one of the things they're surrounded by is Italian art. And you look at Da Vinci, and he has science on the one hand and art on the other. And bringing them both together, it feels perfectly natural and obvious to him. And yet people have divided it up. So I did wonder if that was not going to work. Have we had a place which is... There have been some which have been riotously successful and some which have been less so, but nothing which has not been success. The average satisfaction rating for the seminars is 94%.
And I think, Richard, the point is that you're working with people's brains as they're working naturally.
And, yes.
Many scientists are saying they were actually incredibly creative people, so I don't think we need that split between science and creativity. Mm.